March 3, 1913, history was made in the nation's capital. Lawyer Inez Mulholland, clothed in a white cape, mounted on a white horse, led the great woman suffrage parade down Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C. More than 5,000 marchers followed behind her, along with 9 bands, 4 mounted brigades, 3 heralds, and 24 floats. Organizers of the parade, led by suffragists Alice Paul and Lucy Burns, planned the parade for the day prior to Woodrow Wilson's first presidential inauguration in hopes that it would turn attention to their cause, winning a federal suffrage amendment and gaining the votes for women across the nation. For male supporters of the women's suffrage, all of them had come in participation from around the country to march in a spirit of protest against the present political organization of society from which women are excluded. The procession began late, but all went well for the first few blocks. Soon, however, the crowds, mostly men in town for the following day's inauguration of Wilson, surged into the street, making it almost impossible for the marchers to pass. Some hurled insults, others hurled lighted cigar butts. Some spit on the women marchers. Others slapped them, mobbed them, or beat them. The parade organizers had obtained the necessary police permit for the march, but the police did nothing to protect them from their attackers. Occasionally, only a single file could move forward. As one witness explained, there was a sort of spirit of levity connected with the crowd. They did not regard the affair very seriously. 200 marchers were injured and taken to the local emergency hospital. For 6 hours, ambulances came and went, fighting their way through the angry crowds against the women's parade. Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson, responding to a request from the chief of police, authorized the use of cavalry troops from nearby Fort Myer to help control the crowd. The mistreatment of the marchers by the crowd and the police roused great indignation and led to the congressional hearings where more than 150 witnesses recounted their experiences. Some complained about the lack of police protection and others defended the police. Before the inquiries were over, the superintendent of police of the District of Columbia had lost his job. Despite the enormous difficulties, many of those in the parade completed the route, which was the procession near the Capitol to the Treasury Building. When the procession reached the Treasury Building, 100 women and children presented an allegorical tableau written specifically for the event, showing those ideals towards which both men and women have been struggling through the ages, and towards which, in cooperation and equality, they will continue to strive. The scene began with the Star-Spangled Banner, and the commanding figure of Columbia, dressed in national colors, emerged from the great columns at the top of the Treasury Building steps. The character Charity entered with a path strewn with rose petals. Liberty followed to the triumphal march, and a dove of peace was released. In the final tableau, Columbia, surrounded by justice, charity, liberty, peace, and hope, all flowing in robes and colorful scarves, with trumpets sounding, stood to watch the oncoming parade. The New York Times of 1913 described the pageant as one of the most impressively beautiful spectacles ever staged in this country. The organizers of the parade intended its floats and pageant to have visual appeal for the media and thus to attract publicity for the movement. When Woodrow Wilson arrived in Washington, D.C. on the day of the parade, he expected to be met by crowds of people welcoming him for his inauguration as United States President the next day. But very few people came to meet his train. Instead, hundreds of thousands of people were lining the Pennsylvania Avenue, watching a women's suffrage parade. The next day, Wilson would be driven down the miraculously clear police line of Pennsylvania Avenue, cheered on by a respectful crowd. The Washington March came at a time when the suffrage movement badly needed an infusion of vigor, a new way to capture public and press interest. Women had been struggling for the right to vote for more than 60 years, and although the progress had been made in recent years on the state level, with 6 western states granting women suffrage, the movement had stalled on the national level. Delegates from the National American Woman Suffrage Association, also known as the NAWSA, had arrived in the national's capital every year since 1869 to present petitions asking that women be enfranchised. Despite this annual pilgrimage and the millions of signatures collected, debate on the issue had never even reached the floor of the House of Representatives. In 1912, Teddy Roosevelt's Progressive Party became the first major political party to pledge itself to task the securing equal suffrage to men and women alike, but the progressives lost the election. In November of 1912, as suffrage leaders were casting about for new means to ensure their victory, Alice Paul arrived at the NAWSA annual convention in Philadelphia. A 28-year-old Quaker from New Jersey, she had recently returned to the United States, fresh from helping the militant branch of the British suffrage movement. She had been arrested repeatedly, been imprisoned, gone on hunger strike, and been forcibly fed, an experience she described in an interview as revolting. The parade was a leading success towards the women's suffrage movement to be passed on to the near future. What began in 1913 took another 7 years to make it through Congress. Finally, in 1920, the 19th Amendment secured the vote for women. One event in the long history of women's campaign for suffrage in the United States lies a wealth of telling detail and the human stories that make history interesting and meaningful. A rich variety of suffrage materials in many formats lie scattered throughout the collections of history, not to be forgotten, for the efforts of these women to fight for the vote were successfully met.
There is a house built out of stone, wooden floors, walls, and windowsills. Tables and chairs worn by all of the dust. This is a place where I don't feel alone. This is a place where I feel alone.